Forbidden Diaries.
Dear diary. This morning.
Same premise. You have all these people coming out of nowhere.
I'm not familiar with
Fred. Wasn't Fred Allen like a monkey or something?
No.
No, that was J. Fred Muggs, you moron.
What the hell is Fred Allen?
Fred Allen was like 100 years ago.
Yeah, he had Senator Claghorn. That's a joke, son. That's a joke. Claghorn. Yeah. Mrs. Nussbaum, Titus Moody, howdy, bub. But that's what you do. You bring, you have all these characters.
Say goodnight, Gracie.
We're going to lose one character. Warner Walter.
I just found a labor-saving device. A rich old lady. A drunk walks into an elevator shaft. He falls down 10 flights. He's lying there bleeding. He says, I said, up. You know, a father was explaining ethics to his son, who's about to go into business. He says, suppose a woman comes in and orders $100 worth of material. You wrap it up and you give it to her. Now, she pays you with a $100 bill. As she goes out the door, you realize she's giving you two $100 bills. Now, here's where the ethics come in. Should you or shouldn't you tell your partner?
Famous in the morning.
If you love of a U.S. missile defense system, and it did not work as intended, at least last night.
16, almost 17 after the hour, Howard Fineman, Newsweek magazine, coming up. Live from New Jersey, here's our friend, Reverend Al Sharpton.
Well, I was starting to believe the time would never come, but the mountain finally came to Muhammad. Muhammad being yours truly, the mountain that Adirondack asked Hillary Clinton. After much hemming, hawing, and waiting for the perfect politically exploitable moment, the bolder butt bimbo finally deemed fit to take a meeting with me on Martin Luther King Day. Nothing like tainting the memory of the patron saint of racial equality by using his birthday as an opportunity to appeal to African-American voters. Now, I have seen some pandering in my life, but never have I been witness to such a hands-down, ass-up, knee-drop suck job as the one she displayed the other day. She shared a childhood memory of meeting Dr. King that had a cringe factor so high it was almost off the chart on the insincerity meter. And I've heard beauty pageant contestants sound more intelligent articulating their plans for world peace. According to her speech, an audience with Dr. King inspired Hillary to dedicate herself to public service. No wonder we had such a hard time getting his birthday named a holiday. He's responsible for this pant load in the pantsuit making her Senate bid. Not only is she exploiting his memory, she's besmirching it. Martin Luther King had a dream. This bitch is a nightmare. Now I understand why, after her appearance on his show, David Letterman had to go in for a quintuple bypass. Between the fat in her ass and the fat in her head, he's lucky all his damn arteries weren't clogged. Am I to believe it was a handshake from MLK that inspired HRC to seek political office? I always assumed it was the BJ that BC got in the Oval Office. But even Monica didn't go down on Bubba the way Hillary went down on the black voting community. Of course, you can't blame the girl. Seeing as how all those years she'd been married to that jerk with the junior Jimmy Jammy, it was understandable why she would prefer the black and down with fun. Ultimately, however, Hillary may have done more harm than good for her campaign. Following her appearances in Harlem, she met with the family of Amadou Diallo, the unarmed African immigrant killed by four white police officers in the Bronx. 10 minutes into that particular meeting, and the Diallos were ready to campaign for Rudy Giuliani. I had all I could do to keep Mr. Diallo from grabbing a plunger and going at the First Lady Abner Nuima style. Although if he really wanted to make a dent in her ass, he would have needed something a whole lot bigger than a plumber's hepper.
That'll be fine. Reverend Al Sharpton here in the Amherst Morning Program, and how fitting is it that Reverend Al Sharpton, who lives in Teaneck, New Jersey, here on the stump for Hillary Clinton, who doesn't live in New York either. God almighty. Anyway, the Imus Money Business Report brought to you by the New York Stock Exchange. You can learn more about the world's largest equity. Well, about 2 hours ago. I'll tell you about it.
I'm Joe Tolleson, WFAN 2020 Sports.
Looking for more live coverage of the big leagues? Then keep it here on The Fan, because nobody gives you baseball like Sports Radio 66, WFAN New York.
Gonna get married, going to the chapel, and we're gonna get married. We really love you, and we're gonna get married. Going to the chapel alone.
pretty cold, I'm in. Now, the other one's twice as long. We don't need to hear that. Let me hear 420. That's okay, but let me hear 421. This is pretty good. No. That's pretty lame. All right, let me hear 422. I was working at Magma Copper in Superior, Arizona, in a copper mine. When this record just shot to number one. That's a good one. 423. That's a Joey DeFalso idiot. Joey DeFalso idiot there.
It's great.
Yeah, they're good. Well, they're okay. They're enough. You know, I'm not a big oldies fan. That's the problem. I mean, they're okay, but Chapel of Love, you remember, Lieber and Stoller formed their own record company back in the 60s.
Yeah.
Redbird Records, I believe it was called. And that was their first release.
Was it?
The Dixie Cups and Chapel of Love. It just immediately went to number one.
Yeah.
So. God. Well, you know, there are times we can use this, right? I mean, stuff will come up. And
sure, absolutely. Come on.
Hopefully not often.
Well, a couple of them are pretty good, don't you think?
Of course. I'm just kidding.
Oh, okay. Chris Dodd's going to be on his 20. He hasn't been on in a while, and we like him. Let's see what he's thinking. The debate's left or anything like this.
Ocean. There was a Cuban-eyed boy, a six-year-old boy, who started all of the commotion. He washed up on shore. No, I can't take no more. No more sport for more. He was Miami-bound, but his mama's on ground. Little problem with her flotation. Papa said he can't stay in the U.S. of A. Fidel don't approve of immigration. Send him on his way. That kid was going, send him on his way. I'm sick and tired of looking at his face. No more ring around the rosy. Send him back to Havana. Kick Ilyich Kulov back down to Cuba. Kick Ilyich Kulov back down to Cuba. Oh! Now the end of the drama is two grandmamas over here with their bilingual pleas.
another pair of pigs. Soon this kid'll be big enough to play center field with the Yankees. Send him on his way. It's time that he was going. Send him on his way. I'm sick and tired of looking at his face. Come on, ring around the rosy. Send him back to Havana.
She's a rich girl, she don't try to hide it. Diamonds on the soles of her shoes. He's a poor boy, empty as a pocket, empty as a pocket, with nothing to lose. Sing ta-na-na, ta-na-na, she's got diamonds on the soles of her shoes. Ta-na-na, ta-na-na, she's got diamonds on the soles of her shoes. Diamonds on the soles of the 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 shoes.
I'm a sin in the morning.
We all live business.
I'm going to say this for the last time. I did not have sexual relations with that man. Warner Wolf.
Good morning, Warner.
Good morning. Thank you, I-Man. And one of the great tennis semifinals of all time between two players in their prime. Andre Agassi came from behind and beat Pete Sampras 6-4, 3-6, 6-7, 7-6, in which he trailed 4-3 in the tiebreaker and a deciding 6-1. Here's match point described by Cliff Drysdale and Patrick McEnroe of ESPN2.
Match point Agassi.
Andre Agassi, I think he proved to himself more than ever that his heart is in tennis and in it to the end and for the rest of his career.
Agassi now plays the winner of the Yevgeny Kafelnikov-Magnus Norman match for the title, which has to be a letdown compared to today's match.
You know, I think probably what's helped Agassi a lot in a strange sort of way is being hooking up with Steffi Graf, who's a great tennis champion.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But great heart and...
Yes, absolutely.
You know, and yeah. So I bet in a strange sort of way that's provided him with the impetus to... Not that he didn't have any courage himself, he does, but...
That's right.
So Charles and I were talking back in the office. It's not that we don't like Pete Sampras. I do like him. But I did. I was hoping Agassi won, and as you said, he did.
Everybody pulls for Agassi. It's too bad because Sampras is one of the greatest players in history, but he's not a colorful player.
Yeah.
But so what?
Yeah, I agree.
Right? Joe Louis was not a colorful fighter. Joe DiMaggio wasn't a colorful player.
Fine Warner.
Gotcha. Yeah.
Got
you.
You got the point. That's a, I'm arguing with myself.
Y.A. Tittle.
That's a bad sign.
Sam Huff.
Deacon Jones.
That's right. Yeah. Ray Nitschke.
Yeah.
Earlier, Martina Hingis and Lindsay Davenport both won in straight sets. They'll play for the women's title. Unfortunately, Don Budge, he was a great player, passed away at 84. Only one of two guys ever to win the Grand Slam in the same year. In the same year.
I think I'd sign up for 84 right now, wouldn't you?
You're darn right I would, sure.
If I could sign a thing so you'll make us 84 and then croak, I said, well, you got a deal.
Bring me the paper.
Bring me the paper, I'll
sure.
sign it now.
84 and the ball game's over.
Yeah, that's fine with me. So.
How about when it's you're 83 and 11 months?
Well, nothing you can do about it.
It's over.
It's over.
You made a deal.
You made a deal, and you've got to play the hand you're dealt.
Say your prayers.
You know?
You think
thank you, Jesus, or whatever.
Think of double or nothing at that point?
It's a Viagra.
Or I'll make a trade. New coach of the Cowboys, defensive coordinator Dave Campo, who's been with the club 11 years, becomes the third Cowboy coach in the last four years.
Not the guy with the long hair, right? No.
He has like, no, I know who you're thinking of. No, he has like curly hair.
I can't understand why that guy's ever been a head coach. What's that guy's name? He's the,
I know who you're talking about. Isn't he the specialty team guy?
Oh, whatever.
Yeah, I know who you're talking about. Looks more like a old-time movie star.
Yeah, he does, doesn't he? Oh.
Yeah, or an old cowboy.
Whatever.
Yeah. Just one day after being turned down by a Newark federal judge, Bill Belichick has dropped the suit against the NFL.
Mm.
Pretty smart.
No.
The Saints have asked the Jets permission to talk to Belichick,
probably in exchange for draft choices, but the Saints have no draft picks left.
Oh, trade them all away for Ricky Williams.
That's right, to Washington. And the Patriots have spoken to Jacksonville defensive coordinator Don Capers. NBA, the Sixers lost to the Suns last night. In this game, Allen Iverson made only 7 out of 28 shots from
Good
the field
Lord.
And
what?
Missed his last 9. The Grizzlies, who were 0-17 lifetime against Utah, beat the Jazz 116-99.
Ugly.
Want to hear a great finish?
Yeah.
Seattle beat the Nets 95-92 on Chuck Person's three-pointer. Here's Kevin Calabro and James Worthy of KJR Seattle.
Person inbounds to Davis, back to Chuck for the winner.
Oh, Chucky! He got it, Chucky, baby!
The Rifleman goes riding into the sunset with a win. It was all money. Nothing but big, green Benjamins.
You don't like it, huh, man?
Well, these guys are so tedious. I mean, that's fine. So lame. God.
And finally, the toughest guy in the Super Bowl?
Yeah.
Steve McNair?
No.
Kurt Warner?
No.
Javon Kurse?
No.
It's Rams safety man Devon Bush. Devon Bush. It seems that immediately following last Sunday's win over Tampa, Bush, who's only 6'2", took on 6'4", 335-pound Tampa offensive guard Fred Middleton in the tunnel. One Ram player said Bush threw a punch at Middleton and it landed. Now that's either a tough guy or you got to be crazy.
We're way behind here.
I'm finished.
Okay,
that's
one of here.
Famous in the morning.
This Friday and
over there. And we're going to do some commercials, and then we'll go back and talk to Bernard. And then Warner Wolf is coming up, and a little later this morning, Howie Long and Fred Imus, and more Gumballades. This will help keep Brian's mom off dog food and get some money for June and the kids.
Sure.
Gumballade 2000 here on the Imus Morning Program.
I got the hungers for your love, and I'm waiting in your welfare line.
Imus in the morning.
Let me talk now about, on the program this morning, Bernard, Monteri, and Stefan are over in front of the early morning CBS show studios at 59th and 5th in Manhattan. We expected there would be a group of people there to watch the show who we could collect money from, but apparently that has not happened. Now, there is a big concert happening tonight.
Yeah.
Up at the Frankie Lyman Auditorium, and here to report on that is one of the more famous rock and roll disc jockeys in the history of New York radio, Scott Meany. Scott, so.
Dono, I just received word that Jerry Lewis will be here this evening to perform You Will Never Walk Alone at tonight's Gumballade concert at the Frankie Lyman Memorial Auditorium. And there's a rumor going around that Bryant's girlfriend, Hillary Quinlan, will also be on the bill to sing Ebony and Ivory. I'm telling you, the outpouring of love I'm witnessing here this morning, you know, if I may, I'd just like to make an appeal to the folks out there across the country who are listening to this program on the radio or watching on MSNBC. You may think that just because he appears on national television, Bryant should be able to afford more than $250 a month in support to his estranged wife and two children, but you have no idea how financially overextended this man is. For instance, I have a copy here of Bryant's expense ledger. He just bought a $10 million apartment, and for a man who only makes $5 million a year, well, you do the math, folks, okay? $1,700 a month for mirrors, to say nothing of his medical bills, the Viagra prescriptions, the penis enlargement surgery. I mean, you know, you tip the limo driver $5 here, the doorman $2 there, an extra buck or two around Christmas time. I don't need to tell you, it adds up. Let's face it, folks, Joseph Abboud suits and Italian loafers don't grow on trees. So if you can give a little to a man who gives so much, you don't have to donate a lot. Whatever you can afford will go a long, long way. For instance, a pledge of $288, just 79 cents a day, buys enough dog food to feed Bryant's mom for a year. A $60 pledge, just $5 a month, pays for her dental work at the clinic near the projects where she lives. A one-time-only $10 pledge ensures she gets a spot at the head of the line when they give up the government cheese. You don't have to give a lot. Give a dollar for every Nielsen point the early show is getting in the ratings. You're talking pocket change. So I'd like to implore you to go to your phones, call in your pledges right now. We have a few here I'd like to read. Katie Couric from New York City, $5. Mr. Willis Scott from Greenwich, Connecticut, $2. Thank you very much. See, folks, it doesn't take much. So go to those phones right now. Give a little to a man who's given so much to all of us. Help Bryant become self-reliant. Back to you, I-Man.
Scott Meany, live at the
Frankie Lyman Auditorium, where the big concert will be tonight for Gumballade 2000, featuring Ike Turner, O.J. Simpson, Tommy Lee. Now, apparently they've closed a window on the CBS set over at 59th and 5th. Is apparently slightly annoyed. Let's go back now to Bernard McGurk, who is on the scene conducting Gumballade 2000. Good morning, Bernard.
Good morning, Mr. Ivins. Yes, that is correct. They did close the window. We have a woman here who's contributing some change, ma'am. Thank you very much for helping out. People are being generous. Some gentlemen dropped off a bottle of champagne for when June and Bryant get back together. They can celebrate their good fortune. And we are taking canned goods and cash. If you happen to be in the neighborhood, I can't even talk. My lips can't. We have signs. There's a sign here from Monteria Ivy for.
Forget the whales, save the gumballs.
Support And we do have a version of We Are the World. Do we have time to do that now, Mr. Rhymes?
Yes,
we
you do.
Do it next hour.
No, you can do it now.
Okay, let's sing We Are the World. Okay, let's go, fellas. One, two, three.
We are the world. Let's help the gumballs. Bryant's the one who misses mom on the projects where she was living. Hey, Bryant Gumball, how about your family? You are the one who makes a lot of pain, so let's start giving. There's a choice you're making. You want a hot blonde wife. That's cool, but buy your mom some tea and feed your children. You are a turd, a cheap, dirty a-hole. Just what you spend on Jerry Curl alone could feed a nation. We are the world. Let's help the gumballs. It's true, we'll make the bastard pay someday. Just you and me.
Gumballade 2000 here on the Imus in the Morning program.
All leases closed, and with 2000 cap, 450 acquisition fee, and first payment due at signing.
If you've been.
Scotso.
Donald Scotso here with you backstage at the Frankie Lyman Memorial Auditorium, the venue for tonight's Gumballade concert, where Willie Nelson will host an assemblage of some of the biggest names from the roster of estranged celebrity husbands, all of whom have agreed to appear for free to help out Bryant Gumball, one of the most well-loved people on the planet, a true living saint. Listen to this lineup, Donald. Ike Turner, Tommy Lee, Steven Tyler, Jim Brown, Frank Gifford, Tom Likas, and O.J. Simpson. Just a few of those will be appearing this evening. I don't mind telling you, a couple minutes ago at soundcheck, Ike and O.J. did a version of When a Man Loves a Woman that brought tears to my eyes and a lump to my throat. So I think we're in for a very emotional evening tonight, one that hopefully will also raise a few dollars to help Bryant during this difficult time in his life. I'm told that for the finale, there'll be a chorus of at least 20 divorced male superstars from the world of entertainment joining on stage to perform a song written especially for this event by celebrity philanderers Bruce Springsteen and Billy Joel, Do They Know It's Father's Day, which will be recorded after tonight's show and sold, the proceeds from which, of course, going to the Gumball Fund. Donald, it's times like these when we put things into perspective, you know. I mean, this woman who Bryant is divorcing, June, I don't know what she's thinking. I guess she's under the impression a man who signs a $25 million contract for five years is like made of money. You show me a woman with two kids who can't get by on $250 a month, but let's not dwell on the negative. Let's focus on the positive vibes I'm feeling right now. The phone banks will be up and running shortly for you folks out there to call in your pledges. I urge you to give whatever you can to help out a truly wonderful human being. Gumballade, help Bryant become self-reliant. And I was informed earlier that a huge star was going to show up this morning to tape a PSA to help bring worldwide awareness to Bryant's plight. And there's some, hang on, there's some commotion here backstage. I wonder, can we get some confirmation? Yes, it's official. Miss Sally Struthers has arrived to tape her plea for the Save the Gumball Foundation. Once again, the tear ducts will be in overdrive. Sally Struthers is here. And the outpouring of love that I'm feeling right now is almost too much for me to handle. I'm live backstage from the sound chamber.
About 9 minutes after the hour. Well, Bernard, Monteria, and Stefan are over at Gumballade headquarters, which is 59th 5th in front of the early morning television CBS studios, and where we had anticipated there would be You know, a bunch of people with the little faces pressed up against the window to watch the show. Of course, Brian didn't show up this morning. That figures.
Yeah.
Anyway, let's go back to Bernard now. Good morning, Bernard.
Good morning, Mr. Imus. Yes, Brian Gumbel did not show up, but a preliminary check of the ratings showed that they actually went up this morning in his absence. We are here in front of the CBS Early Show, soliciting donations, canned food, anything you want to contribute for these people. There is a gentleman over here whose car is a roving donation center. Make donations here. And
what have we collected so far, Bernie?
So far, we've collected about $1.75 in change and a bottle of champagne.
Right.
But we're still hopeful. And,
Mr. Imus, we did spend a dollar of that on tea and coffee, so.
Well, I don't think you're supposed to spend the money we're collecting for the Gumbels.
Hey, I'm freezing my balls off. I need some tea.
Imus, but we had children starving in Guatemala and Tanzania, but they're also starving in the Gumbel home. We've got to do something about that.
And also, we got to raise some money for the Gumbel Fund to help Mrs. Gumbel stave off legal fees and assassination costs. Come on, folks. Support Gumbel Aid 2000. Support Gumbel Aid.
And by the way, we're here with Stefan Dweck, not Stefan Marbury.
Right.
As you can tell, he's about as agile as a man with polio, this guy right here.
Did I say Stefan Marbury?
Only about three times.
19 times. Well, I'm Terry Harvey and Stefan Dweck and Bernard McGurk, Gumbel Aid 2000, here on the I Miss It a Morning program. Here now is Charles McCoy with a little news. And if you have an opportunity, stop by the corner of 59th and 5th, Crossman Plaza Hotel, where we would anticipate. We built a $30 million street-level studio, anticipating that there would be fans pressed with little noses up against the window holding up signs.
Maybe five.
Maybe somebody would come over there to see what's going on. But there's nobody there, including Brian Gumbel. But it's not dissuading us from trying to raise some cash for him. So just another effort on our part to help the needy.
Absolutely. Go by and do what you can.
Yeah, here's Chuck. Now, we've only collected a couple of dollars, not even that. And then Stefan apparently has spent a dollar of that on coffee and
that's not good.
Tea this morning, and that's unfortunate.
Yeah.
Anyway, here's Chuck with a little news. Good morning, Chuck.
Just some headlines, I-Man. Quickly, President Clinton heading to Illinois today to keep the spotlight on the economic successes he talked about during last night's State of the Union, visiting the city of Quincy, Illinois, which has experienced...
Well, apparently the police have shown up over there. And I must hope that they don't hassle either Bernard, Stefan, or Monteria.
Oh, I'm sure.
Gumbel Aid 2000 continues here on the Irish Money Program as we try to raise some money for not only Gumbel's estranged wife, but his poor old mom living in a five-floor walk-up there.
You bet.
And, Chicago eating dog food.
Yeah.
And it's
gum and dog food.
Gum and dog food, and it's not entirely, of course, Brian's fault. I mean, you would think that Greg would have something to say about all
sure.
that. So, Gumbel Aid 2000, continuing here on the I'm Mr. Morning program. He's coming up with us. Let's go back to Bernard McGurk now, who is outside the early morning CBS studios at 59th and 5th. Good morning, Bernard.
Good morning, Mr. Imus. We're out here in front of the CBS Early Show studios where a bunch of policemen have descended upon us. They're actually going to do a live remote out here where they try to start a car in the cold. I suggest they get Brian Stark, who's probably been hot-wiring cars to support his family for the last few years.
Yeah.
But in any case, we're out here, and Monteria and Stefan have not fled, even though the police have arrived.
We didn't want an accident.
They're afraid of getting arrested for WWB, walking while black.
But we are keeping our hands in plain view of all the officers.
Contribute to the fund.
You want me to speak for?
Yeah, let's go.
How much money are we?
To the Brian Gumbel family.
Save the Gumbel family. This is Gumbel Aid.
How much money have we
We've gotten a few bucks in the past 5 minutes. Somebody actually donated a can of sauerkraut for the
Gumbo
family.
20 policemen.
It's getting ugly. It's getting ugly out here.
And considering that I am a black man who wants to see tomorrow, I might be going. All right, cool.
Have the police asked you to leave, Bernard?
They have not yet, but they're getting their plungers out, and I'm starting to get nervous, to be quite honest.
Italian segment, how to start a car.
No wonder they serve ratings suck. And, of course, on top of all of this, Brian Gumbel doesn't show up for work this morning.
Maybe they're here to arrest Brian Gumbel for non-support.
Gumbel ate 2,000 near the Imus Mine program, but it's 22 after the hour. All right, now let's go live to the ranch out in the Imus Ranch out in Ribera, New Mexico, and hear from half of your tri-state Jeep dealers is Fred Imus. Good morning, Fred.
Hey, good morning. How you doing?
Well, we're...
The funniest thing I ever seen, man.
Gumbel 2000. Well, Bernard came in the office yesterday and said, I've got this great idea. Because, you know, Bernard's got a big heart. He wants to help people.
Sure he does. Yeah.
And he said, how about if we go try to raise money for Brian Gumbel's family? I said, well, what are we going to call it? He said, how about Gumbel 8? I said, it sounds good to me. So how are you this morning?
Hi, I'm doing great.
Warner Wolf is here. He has picked St. Louis to beat the Tennessee Titans 26-20 in overtime. I just talked to Lupica, live from Atlanta, Mike Lupica from also the New York Daily News. Mr. Lupica has selected the Tennessee Titans.
Well, we're leaving, Mr. Imus.
Have you been kicked out?
Yeah. We're getting kicked out and we're going to jail and we're getting our cars impounded, so we're opting, even though it's cold out here, we're opting to head back to the studio.
So the police have sided with Brian Gumbel in this?
Yes, this gentleman's going to arrest me right now. I have to leave, Mr. Imus.
We got to leave. All right, man.
Unless you bail me out of jail. I'll see you later.
All right, Brian Gumbel apparently he can't pay off his family, but apparently is, well, not, but seriously, paid off the police, but, well, at least we should congratulate the New York City Police Department. At least they're not shooting a black man. They're going to plunder him. They're in this particular case, they're siding with him.
Yeah, wait until they shut the cameras off.
So, Gumbel Aid continues. Yes. Perhaps at some other location.
Could be.
But we expected it would be a number of fans outside the studio there this morning. Turns out there wasn't anybody. So, what if anybody showed up outside the Today Show? It's just as cold. It's about four blocks away, so.
We should find out, yeah.
Find out if anybody showed up outside the Today Show. So, is there anybody in front of that studio?
Exactly.
But apparently not there either. But anyway, the police and the crybabies from the early show, the CBS executives over there, have ordered Bernard and Stefan and Marbury off the scene. So,
yeah.
That effectively ends at least this segment of Gumbel 2000, in which we were able to collect a can of sauerkraut, a bottle of champagne,
right,
and about $3 in change.
Yeah.
So Fred's picked, you're picking the Tennessee Titans to beat the Rams.
Yes, I am.
Lyman Memorial Auditorium, the preparations being made for the Gumbel Aid concert this evening to help benefit this wonderful, wonderful man. And I am told that Mike Tyson will make an appearance live via satellite from England, where he's fighting Julius Francis tomorrow night. Mike, a good friend and someone who's had his own difficulties with women. He will be here tonight by satellite link-up to show his support to his brother, man. The outpouring of love is just incredible. Jerry Lee Lewis has just agreed to perform this evening. Jerry, as you know, been through quite a few wives himself. Although his marriages usually don't end in divorce, he somehow finds ways to get them to die before it gets to that point. The killer will be doing his signature Great Balls of Fire, which I guess you could say is a euphemism for Bryant's package. Chuck Berry will also be here to do a rendition of My Ding-a-Ling. Chuck, of course, a man who sexed up quite a few women in his day, sometimes even with their consent. Another event was just announced that'll go on this afternoon in support of Gumbel Aid. Marv Albert will do a lingerie fashion show at the Plaza Hotel with some of his friends from the La Casa Fall Review down in the village. Once again, folks, however you can help, it'll be much appreciated. Pennies, dollars. But I'd also like to implore the corporate world to contribute. An $8,000 pledge will not only pay off June Gumbel's credit card bills and help finance family therapy, but it also will get your company name painted on the side of Bryant Gumbel's ego, which I don't have to tell you is what? I'm sorry. Is that true? I've just been informed that Bernie and Monteria and Stefan, otherwise known as Bernard McGurk and Don, were escorted from the premises by the police. What's going on here? What, are we living in 1940s Berlin? We can't hold a charity fundraising event without the man preventing us. That's, we're Attica! Attica!
Scott Moody for the Amateur Radio Program. Well, Bernard, Stefan, and Monteri have been removed by the New York City police from in front of the CBS studios where we have been conducting Gumball Aid 2000.
And here now, I'm Mr. Washington's senior military affairs advisor, the late General George S. Patton, Jr.
At ease, as you were, bacteria. I have called you miserable, godforsaken, contemptible, scurvy-ridden rodents here today, not because you make me sick, which you do, but because we face a crisis, lads, a crisis at the highest levels of our chain of command. Gentlemen, I'll be blunt. One of the individuals who would become our next commander-in-chief is a sissy boy.
Oh, my God, no, sir.
At ease. I understand how difficult this fact is for you to hear, but it is a fact. Private, give me a man solution to the lighting in here, and let's have us a picture show. Cease fire! Impressive weapons work, Private. Maybe you ought to run for office. Anyway, lads, roll out the overhead projector. There you go. And give me slide A. Gentlemen, you are looking at the figure of fear who is our principal today. A man whose penchant for turning the other cheek and refusing to pound some enemy ass is a matter of deepest concern. Does anybody recognize this person? Yes, Private?
Sir, the gangly frame, the ill-fitting suit, the red tie bearing the evidence of 1,000 chicken dinners, the angular face with the soft, hesitant, enervated eyes, the sagging, whipped dog shoulder set, but most of all, the neck that looks like it has a shower curtain hanging off of it or something. What the hell is that, sir? Did he swallow a pelican? Anyway, the private believes the general is projecting a photograph of Bill Bradley, sir.
And right you are, Private. Bill Bradley. For whom, believe me, the Bradley fighting vehicle was not named. Because, while certainly not a coward, this man nevertheless would pet a bunny on you. Gentlemen, this is Bill Bradley, a man who wants to be our president, commander of all of our armed forces, the man who could be called on to face down Osama bin Laden, and he won't face down Al Gore. This is Bill Bradley, whose presidential candidacy was just endorsed by the Boston Herald in an editorial that referred to running for president as hand-to-hand combat, a little reality that appears to have been utterly lost on the former senator and current pansy from New Jersey. When, boys, is this good man going to straighten his backbone and get into the fight, rather than rolling over like a bathhouse butt boy every time Gore says the Bradley health care plan calls for shoving old people in front of freight trains, or something equally asinine out of that lying, two-faced, Clinton-enabling fraud? It is full metal jacket time, lads. Time for Bradley to tie Tobacco Boy to the most scandal-ridden administration in our history. It's not exactly like we don't have any ammo. Roll out Johnny Chung and Charlie Tree and the Buddhist monks and no controlling legal authority. Roll out the blowjob issue and the Juanita Broderick rape. Load up Filegate, the travel office, and everything else that happened on the Clinton-Gore watch. For God's sake, roll out the fact that they impeached the son of a bitch. This is war, boys, and by definition, what is war?
War is hell, sir.
I can't hear you!
War is hell, sir!
What are you, Bill Bradley campaign aides? Sound off like you had a pair.
War is hell, you deaf-mouthed!
You bet it is. Join in, maggots. What we need to hear from Bradley over the nominating process then. Somebody cover my back, boys. I'm going in. Thank you for your attention. That is all.
Well, we've been conducting Gumball Aid 2000 over in front of the earliest CBS Early Show studios at 59th and 5th, and the police have apparently now have arrested you, Bernard. What's happened?
Well, they have been threatening to arrest me, which wouldn't be such a bad thing at this point based on how cold it is outside, and I haven't had good sex in a long time.
Right.
But in any case, they demanded my license and registration. I couldn't find the registration, so here comes the policeman again. They're writing me up tickets right now. They won't let me depart. People have been coming by depositing collard greens, canned food, and cash. Here's the policeman again. Yes, sir.
Please arrest the police.
Yes, sir. 10-4. On the way. And,
What did he say?
He just said I have to leave. Now, he brought me back my tickets and he told me to leave.
Okay.
And, Monteria and Stefan are in my car right now. They can't, obviously they can't hail a taxi, so I think I'm obligated to give them a ride home.
Do the police appear to be sympathetic to Bryant? Are they hassling us or what's the source?
Yeah, no, they're hassling us. They were going to arrest us, actually.
Oh, they were?
Yeah, they were going to impound the vehicles, which is, what made us pack up and leave. We were thinking about going down to the Today Show and their rope line, where they have more viewers on their rope line than CBS Early Show has watching TV.
Yeah.
But people are still coming by, dropping items off now at this point, and I guess at this point we should discourage that. Okay, we're getting pushed out of here now.
Well, it's unfortunate.
Yeah. All right, man. All right, officer.
Hey, hey, Bernie.
Yes, sir.
Don't let some cop push you around. Tell him to stick it.
Yeah, stick it. Stick it right up my butt is what he'll do.
Hey, Gene Dilley, how are you? On the Ivy City Morning Program.
Born through a party in the county jail. The prison band was there, they began to wail. The band was jumping and the joint began to swing. You should have heard this knocked out jailbird sing.
Fortunate that the police sided with Brian Gumbel.
It's ugly.
Yeah, that's... At least it represents a black person head. Shoot. Cold fronts, wind chill factors.
My right arm. I had the other two kids with me and my wife. And I accidentally bumped into her because I didn't see her. She turns to me and says, "What the F are you doing?"
Oh, my God.
Like, I couldn't believe it. I was just about to say, "I'm sorry." And I said to her, "Oh, that's nice. Curse in front of the kids." Well, all of a sudden, dukes are up, ready to go at me.
You're kidding.
She wants to fight me.
You're kidding.
I'm not kidding you.
Oh, my God.
You didn't smack her? I was scared. She was huge.
If your radio sounds funny in the morning, you're listening to Imus in the Morning.
My daddy, the wuss. He wouldn't fight back with the lesbian.
Oh, my God.
Look great if I'm there wailing away.
Yeah, yeah.
I'd be in the post
six.
Next day. Six.
Mike Breen punches woman.
A woman. Another thug on the Knicks.
Imus in the Morning. Sports Radio 66. WFAN.
Their Sunday movie, The Hanner Coal Company, just made an easy $16 million. Dumping cyanide near a small Appalachian town. There's only one thing they didn't count on.
What are you doing here, pretty boy?
Steven Seagal.
Sometimes two's not enough. You want to see if you call a few more folks around here?
He's going to save a small town from big business. Chris Christopherson, Mark Helgenberger, and Steven Seagal.
Another fine day in paradise.
In the action-packed network premiere. Fire Down Below, CBS Sunday.
Hello, this is Lloyd Stevens Clark with more good news.
You prove that?
I can prove it. I'm a turtle.
Tell him.
I swear no turtles were hurt by Flashcom.
Yeah, we love Flashcom. They made us stars.
And given us faster internet access.
Right, and it's always on.
Wait a minute. Turtles don't talk.
Deal with my agent.
Yeah, he talks too.
Hey, for internet service that's up to 100 times faster than dial-up, call 1-877-FLASHCOM. There's no dedicated line, so you can talk and surf at the same time. Home service starts at $49.95 a month, or connect your whole office from $119.95 a month. FlashCom is partnered with Covad Communications, the national leader in DSL access. Call today and get installation, modem, and first month service free. Offer available on selected plans. Call 1-877-FLASHCOM or log on to flashcom.com.
Here's a message for all you people on the go. Let's say you're somewhere between Tuscaloosa, Alabama, in the middle of nowhere, and suddenly you want to access your email. You're out of luck, right? Not when you have the BlackBerry wireless handheld device and internet service from RCN. Together, they give you access to your email 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, from virtually anywhere in the United States. And best of all, you need only one email address for both your PC and BlackBerry. One address that you can access wherever you go. And with BlackBerry, not only can you access your account, you can send, forward, and reply to your email messages, too. So get the BlackBerry wireless handheld for one low monthly price, which includes unlimited RCN internet access. Then, whether you find yourself in Walla Walla, Washington, or if you're simply stuck in traffic, you'll be glad you have BlackBerry in your pocket. Just call 1-800-RED-RC.
It's going to take a long weekend when your wife's suing you for support and your show sucks. And now the New York City Police Department have apparently on the payroll of somebody over there, now have threatened to arrest Bernard.
Yeah.
come down on the side.
And Monteri and Stefan, and we thought there would be, you know, they built a $30 million studio over there, anticipating that people would show up like they do at the Today Show to press their little noses against the window to watch this dirtbag do his do this early morning TV show on CBS. And there's nobody there.
Zero.
We collected $3 and a can of sauerkraut this morning. Of course, it's 5 degrees in New York, but so now we're going over to the Today Show, where it's 5 degrees in New York, and there's about 50 people standing outside their window.
Mm-hmm.
So, all right, back more Gumballade 2000 coming up. It's time now to talk some football. Tomorrow, I believe it's tomorrow, they're going to announce who's going to be inducted into the Pro Football Hall of Fame, and there are a number of candidates, among them Ronnie Lott, Joe Montana, Ron Yeary, Dave Casper, Howie Long, James Lofton, and a number of other people, and... Liz?
Well, good morning, Mr. Imus. I think that we should get poor Bernie out of the cold there and maybe get a lawsuit against the NYPD because I think some freedom of speech rights are definitely dampened there. So, and, you know, the other thing is I'm on Social Security disability, and I thought I was doing bad at $512 a month. So we really need to help the woman out, and maybe the NYPD can just, you know, take this lawsuit and give her some money, and we'll have to maybe be happy for her, and we can have this thing settled.
Well, I think you're overthinking this thing, Liz, but what do you like in a Super Bowl?
I think you're right with those Rams. Okay. It's got to be, yeah.
No, 11 after the hour here in the Irish Morning Program. Old Liz in Tucson.
Yeah, weighing in.
Apparently down there, just not a lot to do.
Barely not.
In Tucson, Arizona.
One arm wrapped around. Jim Beam bottle or something. And,
One of my favorite places, although Deirdre doesn't like it for some reason. I don't know what she doesn't like about Tucson, but I like it. So. Some parts of it.
So there's some friction in the I family.
No, friction. No.
Over the Tucson interpretation.
No, she's just not a big fan of Tucson. That's all. All right, it's coming up in 12 minutes now, after the hour.
They played a tape of me saying every awful thing you could imagine about the vice president. And then Vigala is telling the vice president about this dinner last night.
Yeah.
This would like you to say something nice about Imus and...
Oh, my God.
The next thing you see is what? Gore in a cowboy hat in an Autobahn Express jacket.
Oh, no, God.
No. It was sickening.
No, no.
Well, no, I'm not, I'm not endorsing Al Gore at this
not,
point.
Not, not
for the
at
president.
19 in the morning.
You're good. God,
we've seen it all.
No. I'm just saying.
You're a whore. You are a whore.
If your radio sounds funny in the morning, you're listening to Imus in the Morning.
Good morning, Mr. Russert.
Good morning, Mr. Imus.
And here's the thing about Gore. This is the final reason not to vote for him on this humiliation last night.
They played all the things that you said about Gore.
That was awful.
Right? I mean, one worse than the other, and he still put the hat and jacket on.
Oh, man.
Now, what does that tell you about his loyalty to Bill Clinton?
Nothing's worse in the business of lending or leasing than stringing somebody along.
Al Ebner answers 25 after the hour.
All right, here now from his home in New Jersey, our friend, Reverend Al Sharpton.
Everybody complaining about Brian Gumbo not being accountable as a parent, abandoning his children, refusing to pay adequate child support. So then how come the United States government is trying to keep a 6-year-old Cuban boy away from a man who wants to continue carrying on his responsibilities as a father? I am outraged at this whole Elian Gonzalez mess. Like we don't have more than enough coochie fritos running around this country as it is already, we got to keep one here against his daddy's will? I say that unless Kathy Lee needs another muchacho to sew buttons on her polo shirt for 16 cents a day, we should send this kid's ass back to Havana y muy pronto. I am not a racist. I believe that Cubans are among the most valuable members of modern civilization. All you got to do is smoke a Cohiba Robusto to know they more than pulling their weight in the world. Not to mention their many contributions to the fields of art, literature, music. In fact, about the only thing the Cuban people ain't all that good at is sailing. I mean, there's a reason why Cuba don't sponsor a crew in the America's Cup. You don't have to be Admiral Nelson to know that a couple of mattresses tied together ain't exactly seaworthy. Not to make light of the tragedy of the refugees. I'm sure life under Castro's dictatorship isn't utopia. You got to be pretty dissatisfied with your existence in the country to want to float your ass across the Atlantic in a damn minute tube. But if your itinerary includes a few days of treading water, then perhaps you need to choose another agent to book your travel plans. Jesus, ain't there no easier way to get into this country than doing the doggy paddle on a screen door through shark-infested waters? I know Cubans are prevented from traveling to the U.S. Well, then why not just fly over to Guadalajara and cross the border hidden in a potato sack with the Mexicans? The fact remains that if Elian's mama had only been a better swimmer, none of this would be an issue, which makes the Gonzalez matter nothing more than a custody battle. Unfortunately, the mother left her visitation rights in Davy Jones' locker. The boy's fat grandmamas want him back. His daddy want him back. So why is this kid still living with his aunt? Is the quality of life in Miami that much better than it is in Havana? Maybe Elian don't have Pokemon or Game Boy down in Cuba, but I bet you he can have a whole mess of fun chasing a live chicken around his Papa Cena's living room. Go home, Elian. And while you're at it, take Gloria Estefan, Ricky Martin, and Jennifer Lopez with you.
28 after the hour here on the Action Line program. All right. Here come Rhyme and Simon now. Man.
Out of Havana on an inner tube, adrift to the Atlantic Ocean. There was a Cuban boy, a six-year-old boy, who started all of the commotion. He washed up on shore. He washed up on shore. Now I can't take no more. He was Miami bound, but his mama's on ground. Little problem with her flotation. Papa said he can't stay in the U.S. of A. Fidel don't approve of immigration. Send him on his way. It's time that kid was going. Send him on his way. I'm sick and tired of looking at his face. I'm wandering around the rosy. Send him back to Havana. Play a pig, soon this kid'll be big enough to play center field with the Yankees. Send him on his way. It's time that he was going. Send him on his way. I'm sick and tired of looking at his face. I'm all ring around the rosy. Send him back to Havana.
City police officers who arrested Bernard and Stefan and Monteria.
Just 1 minute,
what,
there,
bunch
Mr.
Of, bunch of, another bunch of cops on the take.
Just 1 minute there, Mr. Ramos.
Probably all over there grabbing a plunger. We're waiting to shoot Monteria and Stefan 41 times.
I gotta
times.
Tell you, Mr. Ramos, I gotta tell you,
51
Bernard,
times.
That plunger joke is as funny today as it was 5 years ago when Bernard first told it.
Yeah.
Besides, we moved into the 20th century, the new millennium.
Why would they threaten to arrest Bernard? Well,
you're asking me what goes on in Manhattan when I'm a Brooklyn cop. I really wouldn't know what they do over there in Manhattan.
Well, obviously, they're on the take from somebody at CBS.
I'm deeply offended by that comment. I really am.
Okay.
This is, I think it's called zero tolerance.
Okay.
Zero tolerance. And even
you would think the police
level playing field, as the last commercial just said.
You would think the police would be on our side.
Sure.
The police don't take sides.
Well,
if I heard it correct, man, I'm old-fashioned. I only listen to the radio. But from what I could gather listening, Bernard and his friends were over there with a megaphone, I guess,
yeah.
Some sort of a sound amplification device.
Yeah.
Did they have a permit?
No.
Right. Well, that's it's either unlawful assembly or there's another thing under city code.
Oh, sure.
I'm serious.
I bet $20 would have taken care of that.
I'm sorry?
$100 for taking care of that.
Like I said, those comments deeply offend me. They really do.
What do you want?
Well, I mean, you are the man of the people.
What? Are you
the man of the people?
Are you out on the street, by the way, or are you riding around in a car sitting behind some desk?
My job now is I'm in Patrol Services Bureau. Okay, I'm out there in the street. I don't ride the desk.
Oh, you are.
Now, I really, in fact, I don't think in my 19 years of police work, I've really never had any desk jobs.
Are you in a car?
When I'm outside, I'm in a car most of the time. Sure, okay. I'm not in a car, or sometimes I get out and walk around. Depends on what I have to do.
Do you keep your hat on all the time?
I always do. I'm very proud of that silly-looking hat, yes.
Yeah. Let's see, these cops, a lot of them around. Well, they're all fat, too, by the way, a lot of them, so I'm very irritated with the police this morning.
I know. I heard you on the radio, and like I said, I think you're taking it very personally. They're just doing their job. They really are.
Well, they should have arrested Brian Gumbel if they're doing their job. The guy's a dirtbag.
That's up to the Supreme Court to issue a warrant, sir.
That's
a civil matter, not a police matter.
All right.
Anyway, are you the man of the people?
Yes.
Well, as one of the little people, I want you to keep this fight alive. I want you to go to New Hampshire and keep this fight alive, please. Your friends Russet, Matlin, and Carver, who I all love, people like Leslie Stahl, these people are all talking like this is a two-man race for president, and this is really aggravating me. I want this to remain at least a four-man race. I mean, McCain and Bradley have to, you know, if you've got anything to say about it, you got 15 million listeners, please keep these people in the race.
Well, yes, but I mean, Bradley's got to start acting like a man, you know?
Absolutely. He's got to step up. But yeah. It just, like I said, friend, I mean, I love Tim Russet, and I like Carville and Matlin, but they're all talking like there's only two people in the race for president.
I know. They're trying to dictate to us what's going to go
exactly.
on.
Exactly. And that's what bothered me, one of the little people.
Yeah, I don't blame you.
And
we're offended, too.
Okay, thanks. I appreciate it. I'd really like you to keep this alive. Now, as far as Leslie Stahl was on your show the other day, and you were talking about what a great sense of humor she had, about, you know, you taking a shot at her. Well, she's got to keep a good sense of humor.
Right.
Otherwise, her husband, you know, won't be able to come on your show and sell those crummy, stupid, boring books, right?
Yeah, my wife claims she's a weasel, by the way.
Well, I'm not sure why she said that.
I tend to agree with Deirdre, by the way.
Well, I mean, she's weaseling coming on your show and sucking up to you because, like I said, her husband writes those crummy, boring books.
Well,
I'm sure he's going to write another one that she's going to want to come on your show and sell.
Let's not beat him up. I mean,
Let's
not beat him up. He's got a big enough cross to bear.
Well, I understand. But she was right about one thing. You know, she did call you thin-skinned, and I got to agree with her. You are a little sensitive, you know.
Shut up. I'm not either.
Yo, mic check.
Woo!
Testing. 1, 2, 12. What up?
I'm a in the morning.
All right. Gumbel 2000. Here's this morning, Irish Fun program sponsored by Joseph Abood.
No, it's not sponsored by Joseph Abood.
Discover the world of the award-winning designer Joseph Abood. You probably know Abood for the signature cut of his luxurious suits and jackets. But the world of Joseph Abood offers many other products to fit your lifestyle. Sophisticated sweaters plus corduroys are a relaxed, elegant option for casual office wear and evening out. Comfortably cut khakis, colorful knit shirts have a classic sports look perfect for the weekend. And for the golfer in your life, sports wear that crap. Joseph Abood, you gotta love it. This spring, look for the launch of Joseph Abood's home collection featuring the designer's distinctly beautiful blend of color and texture. Whether it's menswear accessories, home furnishings, remember that the Joseph Abood label assures you of enduring style and quality. Find his latest collections of clothes and accessories at such fine stores as Bergdorf Goodman, Neiman Marcus, Saks Fifth Avenue, Bloomingdale's, Nordstrom, Missiles of Westport. Discover the world of Joseph Abood, the official designer of the I'm Just Playing program and the sponsor of Gumbel 8000.
God.
They're trying to raise money for that dirtbag family.
Yeah.
Rob Bartlett and Bart Less, the XL 2K tour continues at the Community Theater in Morristown, New Jersey, Saturday, February 12th, and they'll be at the Weinberg Center for the Arts in Frederick, Maryland on Saturday, February 19th.
Hey, how are you? I'm John Fincher, official, unofficial spokesperson for Boston Mass. People ask me,
it's one more way they're making shopping for you better than ever. I'm Lori McNichol for the Toyota Fan Highway Patrol.
All right, line two here on the IMS Morning Program at 16 until the hour. Jeff from Chapel Hill. Good morning, Jeff.
Good morning, Don. How are you doing?
All right, baby.
Listen, I'm coming up that way. I wanted to see if I could get some tickets to this Gumbel 2000 benefit concert.
Well, it's happening tonight. Let's check in with Scotso now. Good morning, Scotso.
Dono, I'm backstage here at the Frankie Lyman Memorial Auditorium where the phone banks have been set up and are fully operational, although, as I'm sure you can hear, they're not exactly ringing off the hook.
No.
Folks, you'll have no problem getting through with your pledges for Gumbel Aid to help Brian out in taking care of his ex-wife and kids. and his mom. You know, old people may not eat all that much, but a can of dog food is still a can of dog food, and it's not going to materialize all by itself in her cupboard. So please phone in with your pledges. We have a couple here I'd like to read. Paula Zahn, $2. Al Roker, $1. Diane Sawyer, 50 cents. Thank you so much. It all adds up, folks. The outpouring of love is truly inspirational, especially for the Gumbel children I'm in. Kathy Lee Gifford just called about 5 minutes ago, so moved by Brian's plight, she has generously offered to give his kids jobs in her clothing factory. Rosie O'Donnell has made it known she'll be more than happy to adopt them should June Gumbel find she can't make the ends meet on the $250 a month that Brian is sending. Oprah Winfrey said that she would eat them. Is this a typo? I'm sure it means she's willing to take them out to eat. We're still waiting for the corporate pledges to roll in for a donation of $5,000. You can have your company's name printed on the boxes of the Army surplus chicken byproducts that Bryant sends his mom every month. For $10,000, you will ensure that Bryant is kept in Italian loafers every week. Pick up those phones. Let your wallet do the talking for your heart. There are still tickets available for tonight's concert featuring Ike Turner, Tommy Lee, Jim Brown, Frank Gifford, and O.J. Simpson, among others. There are plenty of tickets. In fact, at this point, it looks like it's going to be festival seating. We have more folks on the bill than actually in the house. So we've... What? Well, Donald, we may have to break away here. It seems there was some ugliness backstage between O.J. Simpson and Hillary Quinlan. Brian's girl... What? Do we know where he's headed? I'm in. If there are any cops listening, if they can break themselves away from arresting Bernard McGurk and Don, there's a white Bronco headed westbound on Route 80. Well, someone call a paramedic. Backstage at the Frankie Lyman Memorial Auditorium. This is Scott Billy Anderson.
I'm a friend of mine in 2020 sports with that little monkey ass whiner wolf. Give the damn scars, boy.
Good morning, Warner.
Thank you, I-Man. The Simus in the Morning Sports Report is brought to you by Amtrak. NBA last night, the Jazz lost to the Blazers, the Jazz of Utah. J-A-Z-Z. Come on, Jazz. The Jazz. As in all that Jazz, lost to the Blazers, 85-75. Talk about an off night. The Jazz Brian Russell missed 15 of his 16 shots from the field.
What?
Stiff.
He missed 15 out of his 16 shots.
Oh, my God.
After the game, Russell said, you can't make them all. How bad is this?
What?
The worst college game of the night. If you took Northwestern and 29 points, you lost.
What?
Listen to this final. Michigan State 59, Northwestern 29. It is believed to be the first time in the history of the Imus in the Morning show that a basketball team scored less than what they lost by. See what I mean?
Oh, I see what you're getting at.
In other words, a team scores 50. You know. Yeah. So if you, well, they, you know, if you had that team in 40, you lost, but they might have scored. Well, that wasn't worth it.
But it was a game. What was the final score?
59-29.
So they lost by 30.
Yeah.
They scored fewer points than they lost by.
That's right.
29.
That's it, I-Man.
That is pretty
You've
good.
You've got it.
Way to go on.
In the abacus.
Mike Tyson, 20-1 favorite over Julius Francis, Saturday night in Manchester.
Yeah.
Here's Tyson.
If everybody loved me and everybody was my friend, I'd be an enemy to myself. It's not normal that everybody loves you and people don't hate you. When people love me, I know who loves me. When people hate me, I know who hates me.
Take some
so
more drugs.
If they wouldn't love me, people would hate me without me knowing.
Take more drugs, I'm begging you.
World.
That's a comedy.
Oh, really.
What in the world did he say?
Really, take some more drugs.
If you rape somebody else, please wear a condom.
Yeah. That's right.
We don't want little Tysons running around.
Yeah, that's exactly the deal.
Begging
yeah.
you.
Now, here's the thing. The fight won't begin until approximately 10:30 p.m. New York time.
Right.
That means the fight will start in England at 3:30 in the morning.
Right.
Those guys will be asleep.
Well, yeah, man.
Former Nebraska coach Tom Osborne has announced he will run for Congress.
No.
Lawrence Phillips will be a sergeant at arms.
Tom Osborne. There's a guy with a little prickly. Remember, very difficult to interview in press conferences and stuff, and always copped an attitude about
it. Yeah.
So he may have a different...
Yeah.
Wonder if he has a chance of being elected to Congress. Probably does, huh?
Well, the
have absolutely no qualifications.
Mary Bono's a congresswoman.
Good point.
Torricelli was a congressman.
Very good point.
Any schmuck.
Charles Schumer was a congressman.
There you go.
Yeah. J.D. Hayworth is a congressman.
There you go.
Oh.
Right. So
now it's bad enough when nobody is watching.
Nobody.
Right. It's worse when nobody is watching.
Right.
But when nobody is watching, it's over.
Yeah.
Last Sunday's Jags-Titans game drew the second lowest TV rating ever for an AFC title game.
Jeez.
Dick Vermeil, who went from 4-12 last year to the Super Bowl this year, named the NFL Coach of the Year.
There's only one thing that's important is winning. And if you don't win, no matter what it is or how great a coach you are or whatever it is, guys, you're an idiot.
Yeah. Well, 63-year-old Dick Vermeil. Where is Monty Hall when you need him?
I don't know.
If you're an NFL coach and want to break your contract, let's make a deal. For a few draft choices, you can go anywhere.
Where's Monty?
Bill Belichick, who resigned from the Jets, becomes the head coach of the Patriots for draft picks.
Unbelievable. This guy calls Joe Benigno on this radio station, WFAN in New York, this morning at 5 a.m. Eastern time. I mean,
you want to hear it?
A couple of psychos.
All right, here it is. Here's Bill Belichick calling the Joe Benigno show here on WFAN at 5 a.m.
Do you have any animosity towards Parcells? I mean, are you guys...
No, Bill and I had a good professional relationship for 19 years, and I think we still have that. We had a couple conversations yesterday, and I feel like we're on pretty much the same terms that we've been on.
That's it, 5 a.m. Bill Belichick talking to Joe Benigno.
All right. He's not going to be on with Mike and Chris, right?
No. But he listens to Joe. I guess he was up. Maybe he gets up early, right?
Psycho.
Maybe he's on the pipe.
I think he's on the pipe.
You never know.
But here's the thing. Well, hi, Bernard.
Hey, I.
When did you get back?
I got bailed out about a half an hour ago.
So what was the cops' attitude? Were they ugly or?
They were kind of ugly, actually, yeah.
Really?
Yeah. They were, well, the brass was ugly. The lieutenant... they were going to arrest us and pound the cars, and so we had to fold up.
What was their complaint? We didn't have a
license. We were causing a disruption, and then they wrote out tickets for failure to comply to their orders and illegal parking. So
is this something where we have to get you a lawyer and stuff?
No, it's just tickets that would have to be paid, and
we get the decision to pay them.
Yeah,
sure. Get MSNBC to pay them. They caused this problem.
Yep. Sure, right. Their idea.
Yeah, exactly.
Rabble rousers.
Bastards.
Well, good work, Bernie. It's a great idea. And
yeah.
How much did we actually make?
Well, oddly enough, people started showing up as the cops arrived because they heard about it and then it started coming down. But we raised $7.85. And also, I have a bunch of collard greens here. A lot of people dropped off kidney beans. Right. Chickpeas. So the Gumballs are going to have a decent weekend.
Well, that's good. Gumball A 2000, so not all that unsuccessful.
No.
We're slightly under $8. But the cops, apparently, the New York City cops, copped an attitude, jumped ugly with Bernard and Stefan and Monteria.
We were still successful.
Yeah, well, at least they didn't shoot you guys.
At least they didn't wave plungers at us.
Yeah,
you know?
Exactly. All right, Warner continues.
Well, the point is, with Bill Belichick, change the rule.
Yeah.
If you break your contract and go elsewhere...
should be assassinated. Maybe that's a little strong.
For how long? You have to sit out a year.
Well, he's a creep. Here's the thing I hate to hear is the Parcells and Kraft made up, which, well, you know what that indicates. It's exactly what you said.
Well, sure.
There's a whole thing. It's just an orchestrated, phony, weasel deal between Parcells, the fat little crook Kraft, and that psychopath Bill Belichick.
Yep. Conspiracy.
Yep. So if it's possible for both the Jets and the Patriots to lose every time they play, which is, of course, not, but...
should be.
We can hope it is. We can
change the rules.
Yeah, just change the rules.
They both have to lose.
So they both suck. I hate the Jets now. I hate them so much I can't stand it.
Yeah.
And I don't hate the Patriots. No, I hate the Patriots, too.
Yeah.
I hate that. They suck. I hate the Patriots. I hate that fat Kraft of Belichick. I hate him. I hate the Jets. I hate Al Groves, a loser. I hate that fat Parcells. He's a phony. I hate them all. I hate everybody. I hate Francesa.
Come on.
I hate everybody. I'm losing my voice.
I mean, it sounds like he was out all morning in the cold.
Well, I've got a cold and my voice is gone, so.
Oh.
I'm very proud of you, though, Bernie. You did a great job.
Yeah, excellent.
It was a great idea. Excellent. It was a genius idea.
Excellent. A noble
actor. Montaigne and Stefan, they're pretty funny guys,
aren't they?
They're
some funny brothers.
Yeah, they are very funny. Stefan, not Stefan Marbury, Stefan...
Stefan Dweck.
Dweck. And Montoya Ivy.
And they have a new book out.
Oh, they do?
As well, that they like to publicize. The Field Guide to White People. And they're also making a movie entitled by the same name.
Yeah.
And they'd like to, in the future, come out with the Iron Man and promote their silly book.
Anytime. They have an open invitation. They can appear on the program anytime they feel like
it. Some funny brothers.
Yeah, they are funny. And they're very cooperative and very bright guys as well. So.
And they didn't flee when the cops arrived.
No.
That was a good sign.
All right. Yeah, well, one of them's a lawyer, isn't he?
Yeah, one of them is a lawyer.
Mm-hmm. All right, well, good work, everybody.
I'm up in the morning.
On the HBO Boxing Beat.
2000 Infinity Broadcasting. All rights reserved. Imus in the morning is a crack of Peckerwood and a presentation of WFAN and Westwood One Entertainment.
This concludes the entertainment and revenue-generating portion of your broadcast day. We now return you to the rest of your local programming schedule, an indecipherable embarrassment of broadcasting incompetence that compelled the station to subscribe to the Imus in the Morning program in the first place. The entertainment and revenue-generating portion of the broadcast day, the Imus in the Morning program, will resume Monday morning. Check your local listings for time and schedule.
Day every day, keep your radio locked in to the Fan. Sports Radio 66, WFAN New York, an Infinity Broadcasting Station. WFAN 2020 Sports.
Good morning at 10 o'clock. This is Rich Ackerman, the Tennessee.
Everything but the kitchen sink at Warner, but they played them once before. They have a lot of things to go on. They just got through Tampa, which has got a better defense than Tennessee. I don't think Warner's going to be that surprised. Good hour. Lots to do. In Atlanta, Christopher Russo on a Saturday morning. Come on back. Program. Nice to have you with us on a Saturday morning here at the Hyatt in Atlanta. Good to have you aboard. Christopher Russo's along the way, and today this radio program is being brought to you by Meineke Discount Muffler Shops. At Meineke, you are not going to pay a lot, but you're going to get a lot. That's correct. All right, Rich Cimini of the New York Daily News. Rich, how are you today, babe?
Great, dog. How you doing?
Nice to have you with us. Paul Nedell of the New York Star-Ledger. Paul, long time no see. How are you?
Funny in the morning, and you're listening to Imus in the Morning from 5:30 to 10 on The Fan. Sports Radio 66, WFAN, New York.
What's your pleasure?
Pitcher Coors Light.
Wise. Chip
Dobbico, WFAN 2022.
The 50,000-watt clear channel voice of the New York Mets is The Fan. Sports Radio 66, WFAN, New York.
PC. I just can't do it. Here to one. Lots to do in high at the Hyatt in Atlanta. Sports Radio 66.
Reflections of our children. The tree is the
27 degrees under sunny skies. That's what's happening. I'm Joe Tolleson with 2020 Sports and WFAN. You're home for Super Bowl 34 tomorrow at 6.
Don't miss out on the many rewards.
Our radio program this afternoon here in Atlanta is being brought to you by Meineke Discount Muffler Shops. At Meineke, you're not going to pay a lot, but you're going to get a lot. Nice to have you aboard here on Sports Radio 66. And if you're Chris Carlin or Stevie Cohen or Bob Schusen on Monday, you got a nice travel day. Atlanta into New York, where you have about 9 billion nonstops per day. Per day. I mean, you could go to 5 a.m., 2 o'clock in the morning, you get a nonstop. But on Monday morning at 9:45, when everybody else, including Lee Davis, the general manager of the radio station, is taking his limo to the airport and getting in first class to go home, when you're Steve Cohen and you're Bob Wischusen and you're Chris Collin, you will get back in coach in 36 B, C, and E, and you will fly an MD-80. You know where? Cleveland. Then an hour and a half layover, and you will fly into LaGuardia, weather permitting, when you took off from Newark, when it came down. And as Wischusen, who's very upset, told me about this on Thursday night, he says, this is crazy. They're looking to save money. Don't they know that I got to rent a car service to go to Newark, LaGuardia, New York, to get my car? So FAN thinks they're pulling a fast one by making me go through the Cleveland and get home from Newark to LaGuardia. I'm going to make up the money anyway because I'm taking a car service back to Newark to get my automobile to drive home. What are you dopes, all of you? And, of course, that does not beat the historical travel proportions of 3 years ago from one Mr. Cohen, who somehow, in New Orleans, to get home, had to drive to Baton Rouge, puddle jumper to Houston, home, all with Bill Daughtry. Oh, baby. That's a rough one. Say something funny, Stevie.
It was no picnic.
How in the world are we flying Anthony Davis to Cleveland on the way home? What are you doing here? Put these poor guys on a nonstop, my gosh. Ah, it's not Chernoff. He's had a rough week because it is. Chernoff flies nonstop on an 8-seat plane, goes 700 miles an hour, 10 minutes to coast with Imus, with a stewardess, and these poor slobs in the back of the plane through Cleveland. Gee whiz. And by the way, this is for Donovan Welsh, who's here, because we were killing the airline the other day. Continental Airlines is by far the best airline that flies today. It is a magnificent, phenomenal airline. And, you know, they made a mistake. Everybody can make a mistake. God, I've lost my luggage on British Air. I've lost it all over the place. Continental is the best airline going. It is a magnificent, magnificent airline, and because they happen to lose his golf clubs and lost his bag, hey, that's happened to me a billion times. Every airline I fly, it's happened. Everyone.
It's so good, they put me on two going home.
Oh, baby. So Continental is the best airline going, Lee. Tell that buyer, we'll put her on, we'll make her happy. We love Continental. Continental. Yeah. That make you happy. 12:10. Hey, I'll tell you one other thing. All the poor slobs, including yours truly, I'm in a cell block up with my wife in room, I won't tell you the room you call, up here in Hyatt. I'm in a cell block. When she wants a shower, I got to leave the room. When I have a shower, she's got to leave the room. Doesn't make any difference anyway, but I mean, you know. We actually only have one bed. Lee Davis and Connie Fitzgerald and Donovan Welsh. All these people, they were DeFore Howard David. Mister, I'm in Charlotte. I get the Celtics. I missed the NFC Championship game. I'll watch it. They're at the Four Seasons in Atlanta. I went there yesterday. That hotel is cap. Don't give me this airline. You're Connie Fitzgerald's waving me off. You're at the Four Seasons. You got maitre d' service. You got fireplaces in your room. You got logs. It's like the lodge in Pebble Beach. Lee Davis is at the Four Seasons. They give him breakfast in bed. It's $5.99 a night. Lee Davis. And I'm sitting here with poor my wife who's killing me. Oh, Chris, I can't believe it. What are we doing? Honey, I can't help it. Lee's at the Four Seasons. Nothing I can say. Blah, blah, blah. Connie Fitzgerald, same thing. The promotions director is at the Four Seasons Hotel, and Chris Russo's at the Hyatt. That ain't right. And Mike's at home. And Cohen's flying through Cleveland.
Any Indian tickets?
Indian Caravan, Monday afternoon. You can hang out with Johnny Hart.
All right, 12-11 on the Fan, Sports Radio 66.
It's Super Bowl 34, tomorrow night, as Tennessee meets St. Louis. Our coverage begins at 6 p.m. here on the Fan, Sports Radio 66, WFAN New York.
In 20 minutes, I'm Joe Tolleson, WFAN 2020 Sports.
Listen to Imus in the Morning, broadcasting live from New Hampshire, covering the primary, Monday and Tuesday, from 5:30 to 10 a.m., here on the Fan, Sports Radio 66, WFAN New York.
Attention.
Nice to have you with us here today with Dan Shaughnessy, the boss.
Every 20 minutes, this is John Minko, WFAN 2020 Sports.
It's Imus in the Morning on the road to cover the New Hampshire primary tomorrow and Tuesday from 5:30 to 10 a.m. exclusively on The Fan, Sports Radio 66, WFAN New York.
The Founding Fathers must be...
$9.5 million, but it's not expected to go to a hearing. The contract would break records set by pitcher Kevin Brown back in 98, 7 years, $105 million. Rangers have won 5 of 6, and guess what? If the playoffs began today, they would be in. Rangers just 2 points back of the sixth-place Capitals after that 3-2 win over Carolina in Madison Square Garden.
It'll take a lot more digging, too. I mean, there's no room to breathe yet, but I like the direction we're going, and we're doing what we have to do right now. To get ourselves back into the mix of things, and that's encouraging because you never know what's down the road. You have to keep working and getting wins right now while we can.
Those are the words of Ranger goaltender Mike Richter, who stopped 24 shots last night. Valeri Kamensky scored for the third straight game, assisted on two others. Adam Graves and John McClain scored as well. The Rangers and Hurricanes will skate tomorrow in Carolina. On the schedule tonight, Devils home to the Chicago Blackhawks, out in the Meadowlands, the Islanders in Montreal. We'll check in on the hoop scene next in Fan 2020 Sports, brought to you by Concentric DSL, providing affordable high-speed internet access to small business.
Before the Liberators came, we moved so slowly.
We found someone shouting, the waiting, the horrible waiting. We got to work immediately.
He just ripped them out, one, sometimes two at a time.
Just doing our job, freeing small business from the madness of motives.
Those people from Concentric, they exemplify the goodness within man.
Heroes? No. We provide high-speed DSL internet access.
Concentric DSL is an always-on connection for the whole office. Now, we have our own identity. It's OurBusiness.com.
They can go 50 times faster than those slow modems. With DSL, this company will advance. But how many others are still struggling?
I have learned to love the internet.
Concentric DSL. High-speed internet access for small business. Starting at only $69 per month, call 877-GET-XDSL or go to ConcentricDSL.com, powered by Kofad Communications.
WFAN 2020 Sports Time is 10:02. Tonight in the Garden, it's the Knicks and Nets, the third meeting of the year, first in the Garden. Team splitting the first two, the last meeting back on December 28th, went the Nets' way, 89-83. Knicks have won 9 of 10 at home. The Nets have dropped 2 straight overall. Knicks trail the Heat by a game for the top spot in the Atlantic, and it's on the Fan tonight, beginning at 7:05. There was talk of a St. John's letdown following that Sunday win at UConn, and last night in the Meadowlands, Seton Hall started quickly, had a huge lead. Renstorm coach Mike Jarvis said the 78-70 final was not indicative as to how lopsided the game was.
We were probably due for a bad game. Unfortunately, it happened to come tonight in New Jersey, you know. I'd rather have it be maybe somewhere in the desert, a lot further away from home.
And what about the letdown factor?
Can you get to a point where maybe you, you know, feel a little bit too good about yourselves? Maybe. I don't know. But as a parent, I'd rather have that than the opposite. So, I just think that tonight we got beat by a team that outplayed us.
In other college basketball action, Indiana beat Iowa 74-71. In Virginia, dealt North Carolina another loss 87-85. WFAN, I'll remind you, an evening to remember at the Mark will take place Thursday, February 10th to benefit the Tomorrow's Children's Fund. Tickets include cocktails, a silent auction, entertainment, and dinner at the Mark Hotel. And for more information, the phone number to call is 1-800-282-3543. Now we'll check in on the weather forecast. Partly sunny today, high of 30. Cloudy tonight, low 22. Periods of snow tomorrow, high 36. Your current Central Park temperature is 17 degrees. Skies are cloudy. It's far away from 70. And that's what's happening. This is John Minko with 2020 Sports on WFAN. You're home for Sunday's AFC and NFC Championship games.
Salzburg with you here.
on another bitter cold Wednesday morning, the 19th of January in the year 2000. As always, the number is 718-937-6666. Schmoozy still on vacation, and Jody Mack's working on one today, so sitting with me is Iron Eagle. It is the Sweater and the Birdie on Sports Radio 66, WFAN, New York.
Revolving hosts.
Revolving hosts. Well, that's what we call a guy who can come off the bench and just do whatever he needs to do. Jack of all trades.
How about I just show up and you have no idea?
Oh, yeah. Hey. Oh, that's the other thing.
What's up, Iron?
We are in the communication business. I figure you're coming in to tape some commercials or something.
Oh, yeah.
It is, you know, the voice of Modell.
Yeah, we got a big Modell's thing going on in the back.
I figure something's going on, and then I find out, AI, how you doing? Well, nice to see you. What are you doing? What do you mean, what am I doing? We're working together. Says who? Eddie sees you at the door. AI, nice to see you.
It's
what
nice.
Are you doing? I'm working for you, Eddie.
Dove Kramer, same thing. Nobody knows.
So apparently...
I barely know.
And apparently Francesca still has
the flu bug.
And
Chris has some matters.
Has some matters to take care of today. So we're shuffling the lineup.
Yeah.
And,
we're basically trying to get you a different host every day this week.
I see.
So I don't even know who's coming up tomorrow. We'll have to wait and see on that one.
Okay,
but
maybe Breen's going to come out of retirement.
Is he?
From the Iman Show.
How about Mike Breen is out of here normally at like 9:46. Today, it's 10:05. He's hanging around the newsroom.
Yeah, no, he was really busted up today.
Yeah.
Sure he was.
Couldn't curtail his emotions. You feel that? You felt that vibe in the newsroom?
Yeah, you know, it was very emotional to watch.